the business forum. We are talking about how to integrate research, education, and business. And this session is something special. It is first time, where is Peter? This first time in the history of the Thematic Business University or University Business Forum. The session is organized outside the main venue. It's never happened. So it is a trial. So we are taking like a participation in the academical business trial to move our meeting one session outside the main venue. So for the welcoming but short speech, we would like to invite director of the Kaunas Technology University, Petras Baršauskas, and later we will go each presenter 10 minutes looking towards the screen.
As professor mentioned, short, I will try, please stop me if I'm not. So dear honorable guests and dear my colleagues, so you are very welcome in Kaunas, who are not from Kaunas, and especially our guests, and I can say that the idea to bring you to Kaunas was very clear and simple. To show that in Lithuania there is not only Vilnius, even there are some special better places than Vilnius. And we always, you see some colleagues laughing, we always historical arguing among Kaunas Vilnius, our former capital, and now capital Vilnius. So including there is an arguing between universities who is better. Vilnius universities, they say that we are the best because we are the oldest. We say, wait, something wrong. So maybe there are other arguments. But anyway, so to be serious, most of you know, all of you know, that last decade in European higher education was a huge changes. And those universities who understand the importance of cooperation with business, who have vision for the future, who simply seek quality, desperately try to work efficiently with business. We can't do research, only fundamental research. Research is supposed to be relevant research, and this is very important. From simple projects, finishing with ecosystem of innovations. And I should say Kaunas University of Technology is one of them who seriously trying to make radical changes towards business, towards industry. For example, in our strategic, one of top priorities is cooperation, innovations, cooperation with business, and to be flexible as possible. So this is why you are very welcome in such conference, in such session. And thanks a lot for being here. And I hope you will share some experiences, some your ideas, and this is most important. This is why we are here. And once again, thank you very much and all the best for the session. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Rector. We will start our presentations 10 minutes, up to 10 minutes each. And later we will come up to the podium and we'll discuss issues with the auditorium, or if auditorium will be very quiet, with me. So, Andrea, please take a podium. Is Chief Innovation Officer ST Health Ventures, and he will tell us a lot about ecosystems, innovation, and the future of the business and academical collaboration.
Good afternoon, everybody. It's my second time in Kaunas and second time in Lithuania. It was 10 years ago, and I'm very pleased and extremely glad to be back. So today, we will talk about ecosystems, and we talk about how they will impact the way you carry out research at university and interact also with businesses, of course. So Ecosystems and open innovation, I believe they are very related to each other. Open innovation is not a new concept, it's something that has been codified about 15 years ago by a guy called Henry Chesbrough at Berkeley. He is still at the Haas Business School. And in synthesis, in a world with distributed knowledge and high complexity that spreads around silos and around traditional domains of science, it's almost impossible to innovate significantly, meaning not in your own incremental domain of operations, but outside of your traditional space if you don't embrace open innovation. So open innovation in practice means to source in the form of licensing or acquisitions or partnering or co-development IP, so intellectual property, and technologies in general from outside of your own boundaries. So it could be from research labs, it could be from universities, from other companies. And this is very important because traditionally, if you see this upper part of the diagram, it was very linear. It was a very linear process. So you got inputs typically from inside the company, inside the organization, and then research, and then development. And research and development were typically very separated also. And then go to market after the traditional stuff that pushes something to market through manufacturing, etc. Here, instead, is kind of the new paradigm. So on the upper side is what happens typically if you interact with other businesses. So like in a B2B interaction, here is what you interact, for example, with research labs or universities. So you can have still inputs, but as you see, in a very seamless transition, you have technology ideas that can be in-licensed from outside, typically university or labs, or even out-licensed, because you may be a net contributor as a company to other people's pipelines. And then you can have academic collaborations in various forms, and I have a couple of slides about that, and up to joint ventures. And so you see it's very different, and the boundaries of the organization that are in this graph are represented by these lines are actually permeable versus being non-permeable in the past. Just a super quick note, open innovation is crucial not just for a large organizations, but also, if not even more, for small organizations because by definition they don't have enough to cover all the domains where they can play. And is very useful for not just for incremental, but especially for breakthrough innovation, so where you enter new markets or new product lines. Here is a couple of thoughts about innovating with universities that I experienced in my life, in my professional life, in the last 20 years. So first of all, it depends if you are dealing with unincorporated IP or startups that are out of universities or research. So typically, unincorporated IP is a better value for investors or for the company because it's less pre-money valuation in a sense, but it's also rough and typically needs more hands-on, more involvement, more interactions to get it to a level where it's useful basically for a company towards a product profile. On the other hand, IP incorporated in a startup, it may be a good idea and a faster path to market because typically some of the de-risking already occurred and you may also incorporate for the reason of attracting other source of capital, typically undiluted funding, either grants or foundation contributions. So for certain players, if the money is not the only constraint, it may be faster and easier to get involved with a startup instead of unincorporated IP. Here I want to share with you a few thoughts and a few examples, and I'm happy offline to give you more details or follow-ups, of tools, I mean, quote-unquote, of interaction and what type of context have been, in my experience, particularly fruitful and useful to spur innovation. And these are examples that I wanted to share from the US, where I operate and when I live currently. So at UCSF, is University of California, San Francisco, and Caltech, which is the California Institute of Technology in Pasadena, where JPL is based. So it's the non-human flights for NASA. They do innovation symposia. So every 6 months they meet, sometime in Berkeley or UCSF, sometime in Southern California, and they clash about a dozen technicians or clinicians from UCSF, for example, and a dozen specialists in chemistry, in basic science, physics, all that, from or new materials from Caltech, and they pitch each other with challenges. So either an unmet clinical needs in search of a solution, or technologies or solutions in search of a problem. And that in about, I attended four of those things. In about 3 years, that thing generated 70 projects, and some of them became also startups. And they fund them with very little money. They're more like exercises at the beginning to see if the concept can fly, about $50,000. And then that will prove that something works, and then they go for the traditional cycle to get money outside. A very interesting model, especially because they were able to bridge communication gaps across disciplines. So converging at a point where you can talk to another field, to another specialist. This is another interesting example. Kauter Foundation put together a set of programs in different geographies of the United States, and the one that I know closer because I was an advisor for them is the Emory Georgia Tech in Atlanta. And here you have again, Emory is one of the big hospitals close to CDC, very interesting stuff on the clinical side. And Georgia Tech, they don't have a medical school or anything, but they're like MIT kind of stuff or Caltech. So they're very interested in technologies, and they force collaboration with each other in interesting and using the actual Carter Foundation as an attractor for these kind of challenges. With small money, not too much money at the beginning, but very focused challenges. Of course, student business plans, accelerators, incubators, there are several examples. In the healthcare biotech space, the Sid Martin at University of Florida in Alachua is one of the biggest examples, because especially the ecosystem that they built with the different sizes of companies. They have large companies, mid-size, startups, exposed to the scientists all day in an offset environment in the countryside, so they're kind of isolated from the noise. So it's interesting. Here is a case study of QB3. I'll be happy to talk offline about that. Here, I would like to just say a couple of things about the fact that companies and businesses in general, they're very willing, in my experience, to access new knowledge, new intellectual property from universities. The problem is to find the right way to engage in a meaningful and effective way that is actually a nice point in between the different identities. So there are several tools that you are probably familiar with, options to license, sponsor research agreements, or research consortia if you're not talking about one-to-one interactions. So research consortia are typically for bigger companies, or if you are trying to get some pre-competitive understanding of a new technology, for example. And typically they have right of first refusals to on the generated IP on a non-exclusive basis. Instead, the option, license, or sponsor resource, typically they grant some exclusivity to the company that engages. There is for those of you in tech transfer, Autumn is the Association of University Technology Managers in the United States, and they did a tremendous job in codifying business practices with university and vice versa. So they have a lot of standard contracts, best practices, international agreements also for institutional collaboration between different universities. And they have also research universities from other nations, so from other places. That would be a great way, a great platform to share some insights and learn and give and take. Here is a model that I want to share with you about sourcing external technology and IP from other places. This is not just for companies, but could be very good for universities as well. My time is off. This is that part that I wanted to do. There is a couple of more slides about my own experience in the industry. Can I go forward or no? Okay, this is just the funding cycle. I don't want to stay too long with this, but this is important. When you plan a spin-off or you have a promising technology platform that you would like to get in the market, designing properly strategically also this cycle of funding is very important to retain ownership and not to get diluted too early. So the idea is in this first phase where the technology faces the risk of early death, and it's typically pre-revenue or even negative revenue if you're investing still in the platform, you want to go on dilutive as much as possible. So non-dilutive funding here is great. 3F is full family and friends. So I belong to the part of the fools because we do early stage as an industry, but not being family and friends of those guys. But typically here you want to go grants, foundation and stuff, and then you go early stage, later stage financing. Angel and venture capitals are typically a good idea to have in your own ecosystem, but it depends if they are with a long-term vision or not. A lot of them, they're flippers that they just want to go in and out without necessarily giving too much attention to the long-term. Here is a slide that is kind of condensating a little bit what I learned in the field in terms of issues that were presented on the supply side of the IP in working with academia. And so often solutions are solutions in search of problems. So this is something that the universities could do a little bit better. So trying to figure out a product profile or at least a set of options of what a certain technology, especially if it's a platform, can do. Because not necessarily is obvious for industry, especially if it's a kind of a cutting edge kind of thing. Imagine, I mean, carbon nanotubes or certain nanotechnologies or new materials. And I have an example here for you. Hyperspecialization is another issue because typically, if you don't have a broad picture of what the technology can fit in the space, then you tend to confine or do kind of hypotheses that are isolating, and sometimes they create invisibility around the technology. So keywords in the search engines or meta tags are your enemies. You should invest in new technology for making kind of technological metaphors out of databases. So basically, even if I don't know that I want a glass, I want something that does the function of a glass, but is not a glass. Today's search engines, you cannot even find anything because if you don't put glass, it doesn't show up. And so imagine this kind of research as well in trying to make more efficient a translation across not just silos, but across ontologies. I worked a lot in knowledge management. It's a big conversation, no time for now, but that's a very important point. A lot of incredible technologies are invisible because of this problem. And I'll give you a super practical example, and then I close. This, we licensed in my previous job, I was working with a pharmaceutical company, a global player, but a European player in the US, and we found, almost by serendipity or desperation, as much as you want. So carbon nanotubes, we licensed an entire portfolio of from Caltech, and Caltech doesn't even have a medical school, by the way. And how? Because out of a conversation like, who is the crazy guy on campus? After 15 times I went there, nothing came up from searches, database, talking to all the hierarchy of the tech transfer, and they're one of the best in the US. They have the best rate of translation in terms of licensing than anybody else, given the number of IP that they generate. They're the top champion in the world in terms of translation assets. But again, they were working in the field. So what we licensed for transdermal delivery of drugs, very potent drugs, both in powder form or liquid form, it was characterized in the database only as a technology for supercapacitors and next generation batteries. So can you imagine, every time you search, and even after we did the project, we invested several millions. Now I can talk about it because next year it's going to go on the market, that stuff. When I still go to meet with Fred Farina, which is the super top guy of the thing, and he's a friend now, I say, you know, look now in the database. We already know everything, keywords and everything, what we did. And still the technology doesn't show. And to me, it's fine because it's the best kept secret. Nobody even knows that we did it. But I say, you know, it doesn't work. So that's a major problem. Anyway, so there's a lot of opportunities in this field. And I think if you are a green field versus a super experienced player, maybe you can approach new ways of doing stuff without replicating the mistakes of other organizations that have a longer experience in tech transfer and translational research. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Andrea. I hope we will concentrate a little bit more about including these problems into the learning process, because it's our aim is to talk how the students could be integrated in this research business collaboration, in what place. So next our speaker is Marius Kuningas. Okay, he is Director General Estonian Intellectual Property and Technology Transfer Center, and he will talk about Entrepreneurial University. Please, Marius.
Thank you.
No.
And good afternoon. Guide in the bus says that Vilnius is most probably the most beautiful town in the world. I want to add that actually this technology transfer office is most probably most beautiful in the world. And secondly, I suppose it's the most successful, at least in Baltic states, because this kind of big joint TTOs I haven't seen in Latvia or Estonia. So I'm very glad about Lithuanians that they have really done something good and new. So before I'm going to speak to you about different solutions and things, I would like to look back at the history and say about why we are currently in a decade where we are changing a lot in European Union and also in Estonian R&D and technology transfer and technology development policies. In 2000s, yes, Estonia was adopting European technology transfer and innovation policy measures, which was actually a first mistake. If we wouldn't have adopted these, we would be much more further ahead. But of course, when you want to be a part of European Union, you have to do also some silly stuff. Okay, the good thing was that actually we got innovation technology transfer agencies, and then also in 2001 we created six technology transfer offices, all in bigger Estonian state universities, which we now found that we have too much or too many. And it also in next slide you can see that actually currently only two have survived, but they are even not in the best situation. So I think actually we should adopt Lithuanian model and actually have a joint technology transfer offices like you have here. Then, which is actually also something which has been a kind of a good case, how we have adopted we have been able to make this bridge between industry and academia was this competent centers program. Basically, all other programs were like throwing money into this gap between industry and academia. So, in general, we were trying to fulfill with money that gap, but you know, it's endless, at least. And main ideology during that time was science push. University should own everything, and all this kind of initiative should come from university side. So that was the result. Basically, we can also see this result already today, or still in today, because top 10, we have two biggest universities, University of Tartu and Tallinn University of Technology, top 10 patent family owners in Estonia and abroad. And basically they own like 25-30% of all Estonian related patents in the world. And now I would ask, what do you think, how many of these patents have gone to business and been a successful cases. What do you think? Almost, yeah, free from like 200s. So, that's today, as I mentioned, we have two technology transfer offices who have actually survived, but they are not still the best or cases. We have now new tasks. First of all, managers should be included in university's top management. Secondly, a central technology transfer policy and regulation should be established. And also, there should be a strong support in faculty level and in the researcher level. Then involving the competence of international researchers and businesses, and more specialization. That's also key because we have only 1.3 million. Estonia is a small market. We do not have many researchers, many scientists. We should focus. And main ideology should be market pull, and university does not have to own all. Basically, it would be better if university doesn't own any patents. Some maybe for just, you know, because universities are very eager to show themselves and they want to speak about numbers, so they should have some, but only for showing, not for the hoping to have a business. So, what I would like to say, it's the main challenge is actually kind of environment in university, because scientists and also students, they should be eager to, as previous speaker was saying, they should be open. There should be like this open innovation model. So there should be freedom to think differently, and they should be challenged with issues from day-to-day business problems. And overall, there should be environment of trust. That I have seen, because I have been in the area of technology transfer for 15 years, that is the biggest problem. When you come to the scientist and say, okay, I would like to have a cooperation with you, then I have a very good case about that. First of all, the scientist had a kind of, solution. And first of all the eyes were going with dollar marks. Oh, now I have possibility to earn a lot of money. But it was just an idea, not a business solution. It was not a product already. And secondly, they are always afraid, and universities, they are afraid that businesses are stealing their secrets. So that's another issue. So, and what universities are still nowadays, they're big organizations, so this means a lot of bureaucracy. So if you want to do some kind of business project, you have to have a signature from your boss, boss of the faculty, boss of the structures, and vice rector, rector, and maybe from university council. So something like 10 to 20 signatures, and the overall process goes through different councils and different kind of collective decision organs, so it could take like half a year or so. And finally, leadership with both vision, strategy, and adaptable plan. So one good case also, it's actually a case of spin-off smart implant. It's about measurement of electrical impedance of the body. So, this is how it has happened, like a business model. Basic research was done in Center of Excellence in the university. Then for the applied research, there was a joint venture between Industry Academy, which was called Competence Center of Elico. It also had the state support. And then, kind of a raw product development. There was not an end product, but it was a raw product development was done between smart implant, a spin-off, and this competence center Elico, and then finally smart implant actually commercializes. and markets a product and sells it to the export market. So actually, that's all from my side. If you come to Estonia, you're always welcome to our office. We are not having all the full building. We have only some office in the fourth floor. So, oh yeah, in future we have the all. Thank you very much.
There was really some good remarks about universities, property and future. Of course, we are talking a lot of these things, but to learn from the speaker is always a pleasure. So, our next speaker is Big Data, Fueling the Future of Business and Society, Joel Portis from Thematic Corporation. So, please, take floor.
And it was this picture that's very famous, and the inscription said to our dear friend, Claude Pepper. Can you hear me okay?
No. Your microphone is not working.
Is it working, Mike?
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Better. Okay. Really?
All right, so anyway, this first picture was the picture that was hanging on the wall in Congressman Pepper's office, and the inscription said, to our dear friend, Claude Pepper, Orville and Wilbur Wright. And as I looked around the office, I noticed another very famous picture, and this was a picture of a man on the moon, and the inscription said, to my friend Claude Pepper, Neil Armstrong. And as I think about this some 20-plus years later, three things still come to my mind. One was that Claude Pepper was really old. He knew both the Wright brothers and Neil Armstrong. The second was, this is, in my mind, iteration at its best. You start with a biplane in North Carolina. 66 years later, they're landing a man on the moon using this technology that continued to evolve. And the third piece was, when great people have a solid mission and understand what they're focused on, the things that can be accomplished. And the way we approach our business at Thematic is, and we take this position with all of our employees, is summed up best by the French author Saint-Exupéry, who said that if you want to build a ship, you don't drum up people to collect wood and don't assign them tasks and work, but rather teach them to long for the endless immensity of the sea. And I'm so happy to be back here. I was here yesterday with the director and the mayor as we opened up the Thematic and KTU Creativity Lab here. And this is what we're trying to do, is bring people in to help them think about the endless immensity of what it is that we can accomplish. And so when I think about big data and within Thematic, if you think about a gigabyte being equivalent to 10 yards of books stacked up, and you think about a million gigabytes equaling a petabyte, and if you think about a petabyte being equivalent to 20 million four-drawer filing cabinets, what we deal with at Thematic is equivalent to 2.5 petabytes of data. It's big. There are others that are bigger. But for us, it isn't just about the quantity of the data. It's about the quality of the data as well. And so data is exploding. There's no shortage of data. We all understand just where data comes and how frequent and how much data there is. and how much is being produced every minute across this globe every single day. In Lithuania specifically, we know that there are about 68% of the population are heavy internet users, and that about 35% of the population have Facebook pages, right? So if you think about this across the globe, there's a tremendous amount of data. And we also know that there's no shortage of data. We know that every 2 years, the data in this world continues to double at that type of pace. But the issue isn't the volume of data, and the issue isn't the quantity of data. For us, the issue is about the quality of the data. So if you think about the digital universe, this is from a statistic from 2013, 22% of all of the data was actually available for analysis. But of that, only 5% was actually analyzed. So you can see that we have a tremendous potential, tremendous opportunities to be able to use more of this data effectively. What we do at Intermedics, and I'm not going to get into the argument of which university is better, but I will tell you that we are over 500 people strong here in Kaunas, and we hope to use this relationship with KTU as an opportunity to continue to bring students into our organization and be able to give them opportunities to understand the data, understand predictive modeling and analysis. And so what we do is we use that data across various functions for our customer base. And our customer base is global emergency management and healthcare administration and management. We are currently in about 28 countries in which we provide many software and data analysis projects that help first responders and physicians across the globe do their job. Our mission is actually very simple. Our mission is six words: to serve those who save lives. And we do it through data, we do it through analysis. And so, for example, we use our different methodologies and analytic capabilities to help organizations prepare for flu. And why that's important is doctors can staff emergency rooms. So the 15,000 doctors that use this service, the 2,000 hospitals that use this service, are able to prepare for when there will be incoming flu epidemics in their regions. And so we're able to break that down. So that's the value and the benefit of what that does for society and for our communities. The other thing that we do, excuse me, is we use our data, and then we use data from outside entities and third parties in order to predict where accidents are likely to occur. And by doing that, we're able to use that data and that analysis for municipalities, for the 650 ambulance companies that use this, so that they can reposition their ambulances in those areas where there is a higher probability that an accident is going to happen. And why that's important is it reduces the response time, which translates into a greater likelihood that in that emergency, that individual that's affected has a greater chance for survival. And it also reduces the wear and tear on the ambulances. So for example, the average ambulance life extension through this program is another 2 years. And if you're a municipality and you don't want to build brick and mortar around your different areas, your suburbs and your communities, you can use this type of data analysis to position those ambulances and not have to have them commuting from the main location, nor do you have to build the facilities. So within our operation here, as I mentioned, we are 500 plus people strong. We'll be 770 people by next year here in Kaunas. And this is a group that manages this master data bank that has over 70 million profiles of patients and individuals that are affected, that we have this data on. And this group here manages that information in order to provide analysis and integrations for customers of ours across the country. I'm sorry, across the world. Across the country, too, for that matter. And the other function that we do here in Lithuania with our group, and where we're able to hopefully bring more folks through our relationship with the university into the organization in order to help with this, is to be able to use our business intelligence tools in order to convert this information into actionable and usable information, usable analysis for the physicians, for the hospitals, for those folks that are administering care and responding to the emergencies. And so how this works is we take data, whether it's utilization data, whether it's claims information, and we couple that with the outcomes that we see from this data based on the analysis that we complete. And from that, we create these scorecards that we then apply to, that our customers apply to their practices, to their organizations. And what that does is it results in a tremendous amount of operational and functional use by the organizations. And this office here in Lithuania is driving every single function, and they're contributing to every single function that we provide for our company across the globe. So with that, I will stop. And I went through that pretty quick, but I wanted to make up the time. So I hope that helps.
More?
Okay, well, I don't have any more slides, so.
Okay. It's good. So thank you very much. In fact, thank you for telling us about big data. Big data, of course, in biomedical research especially, are becoming more and more important. And biobanking in connection with big data, with outcomes, with the genetics, with the treatment, with the participation in clinical trials, and so on and so on. I think in 5-10 years it will be something very specific and on top of all research events. So our next speaker is a host of this event, Vice Rector Asta Punzienė. She is, of course, after rector, she is in charge of everything happens in this building, and it's my pleasure to give the floor to Asta. Thanks.
Thank you. I'm not sure how much time I have,
maybe
an hour, because you know, I need to prove now to Estonians that universities have own IP, so I will take some extra time, but I'm joking. So in general, my mission today to explain what is this building and what we're doing here, and our vision, what we would like to do in general, talking about new knowledge and technology being useful for society and business. And those of you who are first time in university, I'm in short, just want to say that probably a major shift in our understanding came just saying to ourselves that what we want to have in university, what we want to educate, is first of all talents and young people for clear career in the labor market in the world. So our alumni should be able or to organize activities themselves, being entrepreneurs, or they are perfect and desired employees in the companies. Also, that we work on one hand with the new knowledge and rigor research, on the other hand, we work with innovations. And of course, we think the world should be sustainable, so our activity should be sustainable and the environment should be friendly. In general, three priorities that really make us focused on several fields is international, interdisciplinary, and innovation. And probably this helps us very clearly to understand where we are heading. I would say we are a comprehensive university. We have also social sciences, humanities, and arts that also help us to make technologies with a human face. And we are, I would say, medium in worldwide scale university with 11,000 students and 1,000 academic staff. What is very important, probably explains what we're doing here, is innovation ecosystem. And we believe, actually, that university is a heart of the innovation ecosystem in a sense that we produce knowledge. They produce knowledge that somebody has to use. Who is using the knowledge? The knowledge is used by different target groups. And probably it goes to technology development, technology goes to startups, startups work with accelerators, startups work with business angels, matured companies. Probably it's little spoken about the role of matured companies in the ecosystem, and they play a huge role because, first of all, they work with the startups. They really acquire startups as a new ideas and new IP, but also they invest in ecosystem, supporting what is going on, new knowledge development, helping talents to find the place in the world, but also to the startups to grow. And if you can see this picture, here we have two parts. We have knowledge, so to say, part and business part. And in that way, we really make startups and mature companies to be very close to the knowledge. And I think this is something that is very important to understand about this place. By the way, this hall is in the middle between the business part of the building and between the research part of the building. And here's in particular the business part of the building, where our very good partners, matured businesses, by the way, mainly now matured businesses, are situated. Very shortly, who are the drivers of innovation ecosystem? Of course, researchers, but also PhDs. And I think what is very important is thinking about new ecosystem to change universities to work in another mode. Also to change the mode of PhD education, making PhDs and researchers more international, more able to cooperate in different cultural environment, being more creative. And research is really like a hard currency. You know, researchers produce knowledge and technologies afterwards. It's a hard currency in the innovation ecosystem. We exchange knowledge and technology for other goods in sense with a matured business and other stakeholders in the system. So what we have five major research areas for new knowledge and technologies. And we really are and strive to be even more competitive on international scale and patent. And here we try to patent as university. And actually we took American style to license patents. Why? Really to have clear cycle from knowledge to IP, to technology, transfer to business, and the feedback. Here in this building, we have several areas that we cover. This is new materials for high technologies, smart environments, ICT, and diagnostic and measurements. Also, we have the other part of the valley working with the food technologies. And what is very important, I would say, that in general, we say that university is open access. That means that all the new labs you can see here is open. And if you want to check if it's open, you go apcis.ktu.edu, and you can see all the 2,000 equipment and research services that university possess and eager to share with the external world, with the business and society. Some examples and the technologies that are created here, I would say this photo is really very symbolic because most of our technologies helps to make visible what is invisible. So it's very clear added value. We're able to make invisible visible. And we have very good stories how the technologies really not only stay in the labs, but also this particular one in non-invasive brain diagnostic, it's already approved by FDA and ready to go to the market. As you can see, the research is competitive, so we have to work hard to be the best and really to be able to operate what we do. And it's not enough. Research is like a hard currency. However, if we do not create a burning platform where business and research can come together and work, the cooperation is not going on. So still, if even we have excellent faculties and excellent discipline research, we need some discipline, some place where we can innovate and have interdisciplinary research. One of the very important projects, and we were quite successful from 168 applicants, 26 were successful, and we are one of those. It's a Center of Excellence in a widening program meant for establishing Center of Excellence for Health Technologies. And here, I have to say, even if we are not successful for the second stage, already there is a need, a benefit, because Vilnius University biotechnologists, Kaunas University technology researchers, and Lithuanian Health Science University clinical doctors succeeded to work together and find common interest to have solutions for age-related diseases such as Alzheimer's, such as musculoskeletal disorders, and other disorders that really target aging society that is very important in our days. And here, apart from Lithuanian universities, we work with Lund University in Sweden and the VTT is Technological Institute. It's the biggest technological institute in Helsinki. And the other initiative that we really lack is M-Lab, where we really envision, and the picture is not of the building, but just of the vision, as you have noticed. We really need a place where we can experiment and have very quick cycles from crazy idea to trying out if it works or not, and then close down if it doesn't work. If it works, it goes further. So this is something that we see as KTU as deep discipline knowledge, Santaka Valley as really collaborative research, and M-Lab as the place for crazy experiments and quick deployment if it's successful, and so to say, canceling if it's not. And what is very important here, that to do that, art, science, and technology have to work together, because even we have wonderful thing, but it's not nice, if it's not aesthetic, if it's not a human side, it doesn't work in the market. So what we say, we need research lab, we need fabrication lab, we have maker space, we have to have design laboratory, art laboratory, and social laboratory. So all main parts working together and making successful innovations. Who is responsible to carry this on? And I know my time is over, but I just take another 2 minutes, okay? So what we said, that it's very important to have someone in university to guide business through the university, because the problem we had is really that business people were coming, the university is huge. They were knocking on any door, and researchers were looking at them, they have no time, they're busy, business people are unsatisfied, researchers are also unsatisfied. So if we actually have someone who can stream and give the answers, direct answers in a normal time, not like in 1 year or 2 years, but like in 2 days, it works much better. And so we have Innovation Entrepreneurship Center, we have open access information system that really is a one window approach and guidance through the university to the successful outcome. And what we do, we really integrate some of the functions, and we say we have technology transfer, intellectual property management, startup space, for business incubator, promoting entrepreneurship mindset. And it's very important that from students, from bachelor and masters and PhD studies, we have entrepreneurship education and, of course, consultancy. We have a chain, we have a process normed how we do that. And we have information system, I just mentioned once again. And we have success stories. And, you know, this happened like 2 years ago. Then I met by accident some business person said, you know, we need something that would be able to smell, to sense if the meat is good or not. And they said, let's try, we can help. And we went to Innovation Entrepreneurship Center. Our colleagues, they really mastered a team between chemistry technology faculty and electronic faculty. And after 2 years, we have a product on the market. Here it is. It's not empty, by the way. It's really inside there. I will not be able to demonstrate how it works because I don't have an app. So I would have to download the app, but it's really working. Would you guess where it's made? Where it's manufactured? Where? In China, yeah. I think you said China. But R&D part is made here. So we are very mainstream in this. We try to select IP. We try to really see how our technology and equipment is working. And what I think is very important to mention here is our cooperation between Kaunas, other higher education establishment, because as we work together with Lithuanian Health Science University, with Lithuanian Energy Institute and Vytautas Magnus University, we really have added value, especially for health tech, for health technologies development. We wouldn't be able to be so successful without our partners. And also, this is example for synthetic bone that we developed together with the researchers from Lithuanian Health Science University. This is our partners, matured firms, that we wouldn't survive without them. They are really emotion and stimulators of the ecosystem. And the last thing that I want really to stress, that if we start innovation ecosystem, we have to start with entrepreneurial education within the system. And probably something that we are really proud of, that we have two programs for bachelor's and master's in technological venturing made with the partners that really educates more than 100 students per year. But of course, I would say the quantities should be even higher if we have 11,000 students and we have 100 students educated per year. So it will take a bit, you know, to inoculate the entrepreneurship. Our startups, they are 44, and actually they are still all alive, but the lifespan is quite short. It's still 3 to 4 years. It's not an easy process. It's a lot of events and communities working together to have exactly the companies that survive afterwards. But we have a lot of activities to help students to test. And probably what is very important to mention, as we're a small country, our startups has to be born for export. That means that as soon as they are born, they need to learn about external markets and they need to travel and exchange the experience. And this is community that helps to do that. So thanks a lot.
Thank you. In fact, we talk a lot, but I would admit that all speakers are not looking into the main question of our session, how to address these changes in mindset, in the attitude towards research and innovation, how to join it with education, and in what place education should come in as a probably basic for creation of ecosystem for innovation. So I invite you to take your places, and I will push you to talk a little bit about this. So how you imagine how new knowledge to transfer to education, technology, education, and business. What do you think? Where are the proper places to do that?
As I said before, it's I think it's a question of values and environment. So in university you can have knowledge as an education, but for values it's too late. Or the students in the university, they already have all the values. They only gain new knowledge. So value as a entrepreneurship, like a entrepreneur as a person should be given already at school before the university, and then university can give you the tools, the knowledge, and opportunities and possibilities.
Do you think universities, all universities, have these tools, or they need to develop them?
No, at least not in Estonia.
Okay, so probably in technology university, Avikso will make some interesting happenings. Mr. Avikso, you?
Yeah.
I don't know if you know what is Mr. Avikso. He was Minister of Defense of Estonia, previous rector of Tartu University, Minister of Education and Science, and now he is rector of Tallinn Technology University. So it's interesting career. So, okay, so what's your opinion on where to put the education in this environment of innovation and business?
What would you like to know from the business side? Because it's a big question, and so what is the exact...
You agreed to take part in the educational programs of entrepreneurship, research, innovation, business. What kind of people would you accept into your business surrounding, in your business community, to show up and to teach them?
I mean, I think it depends really on the type of organizations that you want to attract and deal with. And so if an organization or a business is looking for incremental innovation, they're probably looking for stimulating very specific response to very specific needs that have been identified somehow internally. Instead, there is completely on the other side of the spectrum, there are organizations that say, no, incremental innovation, we can do it very well. For example, the industrial... I mean, I work for an industrial conglomerate. We are very good in that. We work in automotive, healthcare, surgical robotics, telecommunication. We are very good in doing incremental. But it's a €1 billion company, so it's not small. But we are not focused at all, and we don't want to do disruptive innovation because we think that is the place where you can instead go and find great ideas and great new approaches in the academia. And then translate it internally towards a new business or a disruption of your own current business. So I would say that what we as business and what a lot of businesses expect, it doesn't matter if they're startups or established from academia, would be to be able to look beyond the now and immediate needs. So something that is outside of the box thinking or interdisciplinary innovation that is at the intersection of disciplines. And that is where, and this was a conversation going on this morning, is where being able to design knowledge at the university, and I stress design, in a way that you don't create only specialists able to look deep and deep and deep in one thing, but you are able to look at disciplines almost as a whole, in a cloud of disciplinary aspects, because sometimes you don't know where the answer or the solution will come from. And so if you are too specific or if you're too focused on something, you're missing a lot of opportunities. And frankly speaking, also, Lithuania is such a high potential but also small
countries that if you are trying to compete on the hyper-specialization field, you're going to lose by definition against the Chinese and the Indians and the Americans, that they have 10 times more people to play with the numbers. And so either you can rely on the European and the Baltic also ability to integrate different vision, different cultures, different disciplines. It was interesting on the bus to learn that the very heart of Lithuania at history was inviting people here from different places and being a melting pot. And that's why you became the biggest nation for a while in the world. Not because, and so now, not necessarily number of people, you can do the same exercise with knowledge. If you invite people from all over the world to think and to co-design with you new spaces across disciplines. That is something that very few places are doing. It's very hard to do, but that's why there's not a lot of competition. You know?
All right, we will come back to this.
So I'll try to answer it by breaking it up into two different parts. First part is, if I understood your question right, do universities play a role? And you know, by the fact that we invested in this creativity lab with the university shows our commitment to that. So we see that, and we have similar relationships with universities in the United States. KTU is the only one outside of the United States where we have this relationship. So we think that much of the creativity, much of the kind of the thought-provoking activity can come from being associated with universities and innovation that comes from that. But we also are a very acquisitive organization. So we have done 24 acquisitions over the last decade. And within that, I think to your point, there comes some inherent innovation with that. So it's really trying to couple the innovation, what we do organically, what we do through our acquisitions, and what we do through our relationships with universities. And then the second part of the question, if I understood it, was, you know, what type of skills? So we're an analytics software technology-enabled services company. So as a result, you know, I'm automatically attracted to mathematicians, to data scientists, to computer scientists. But the social science side still has a place in our business because of some of the other intangible things that brings to us. So we certainly want an educated workforce, and I mentioned that we have over 500 people in Lithuania, in Kaunas. Every one of them has a college degree, and every one of them speaks fluent English. And so Kaunas, from our perspective, in Lithuania, from our perspective, and I think a lot of it is driven by our relationship with the university, is not some offshore organization. They're colleagues of ours that happen to be domiciled in another part of the globe. So I think that for us, we'll continue to have relationships with universities because it is a great feeder of employees for us. It's a great way to kind of think differently about problems that we can solve. And we'll continue to pull all types of graduates across various disciplines, not just the science side.
All right. Asta, please, your comment.
Well, I just could add that probably we all know that we should start from early ages, and then parents and kindergartens are guilty for our bad education. But what universities could do in this regard, I would say that in our lifespan, it's really changing the education in general, with the technologies, with the new needs, with really solve the problems, integrating the knowledge in from different disciplines to tackle with a very specific innovation or business problem. We have to look on, first of all, entrepreneurship education, and I think it really helps to not only be entrepreneur, but intrapreneur as well, to be active and proactive within the company. Also, we have to put education hands-on experimentation. So much less lectures, much more experiments within the classroom that helps to try different issues and to learn what works, what not. Because knowledge is something that you now can gain. You can Google and can learn whatever, even nanotechnology, you can Google and read the strategy for nanotechnology for the next 20 years. So right. This is the issue.
So you want to add something? To add okay, Andrea.
Just a short comment. I think, I mean, an aspect that I think is missing in a lot of university curricula is looking at the new ways to enhance our cognition. So basically, there's a lot of research going on in the neuroscience field, from experts in medical field, but then the rest of the population is still in the Middle Ages with that regard. So there is a lot of potential that you can unlock in the productivity of the students, in the way outputs can get generating, in how fast they can grab and learn new things, even if they're already in their 20s or something, which is already late. And looking at what are ways to teach, like how we train our body, how we train our mind to learn faster, better, and I mean in more plastic ways, or disrupt our brain plasticity in new things. Because otherwise, we hear even this morning we learn lifelong learning, la la la, and more disciplines every 5 years you disrupt. It's pure theory, because in order to do that kind of stuff, you need, first of all, to be able to learn and to self-teach yourself. A lot of the masters of the Renaissance were self-taught. They didn't go to universities or anything. And the other thing is how to understand how you learn. So everybody learns in a little bit different ways. There are certain common things. And there are all signs of learning and brain functionality. And we can train that. And I had some interesting experiences last year. I went for a workshop, a long workshop, and in general, I'm going to go to Guatemala with the shamans. And it's something serious, but basically, and no mushrooms, so don't worry. But basically, you can learn from people that are human beings, they're not robots or anything, that actually can harvest more into their brain or their awareness and really do incredible stuff with your own brain just without training, just expanding perception of time, slowing it down, remember more things using a visual memory that sometimes we don't. And the other thing I want to say, you need to design both academia and businesses, and this is more like a political level. I mean, I'm blessed. I work for an organization, and that was part of my negotiation when they wanted me to work for them. That we negotiated in a non-negotiable way, that 20% of my time should be dedicated to things that I think they're interesting for the business and for me, without being in conflict of the business, but basically free time from duties, from things you need to do. Google has a similar policy. So if you don't have time, and if you're overwhelmed, if you're always under behind schedule and stuff, there's no way you can innovate, you can learn new things, no way. And in universities, the same. I mean, I deal with universities every day, and from the little guy, the little postdoc, to the top guy, they're all overwhelmed. They are all. They don't have enough people, and so either is a problem. They're not as effective as they think, and in doing what they need to do. So they need to learn how to work better. But probably instead they are overwhelmed, and so the price for extra profits or extra performance with the numbers at the bottom line and being understaffed is that people don't learn because they don't have time.
Yeah. What I would say. One other kind of, I guess, restriction or maybe a constraint to incubating with universities, right? So we look at it as from talent and talent pool. The constraint that I have with incubation in universities is the ownership of the property, right? So I want to own everything that we have. And so to have to share ownership or to have to yield or acquiesce any of the proprietary rights to some of the work product is an issue that we deal with at the, you know, which will impact just what we'll do with the university.
Yes and no. Probably, look, it seems to be two problems, in fact. One, if to organize research, it's better to organize without universities. It organizes like a private enterprise, and in fact, in pharmacy business, in pharmacy developments and research. American and European companies are creating foundation to support small, medium-sized enterprises, which are free out of these rules, senats, all traditions, all the, of everything which is binding mind of the big company. So it's one side, but on the other side, as a societies, we cannot push all research into the private hands out of universities, because it should be a part of the teaching, what we are trying to talk about. So could you reflect on this?
Yeah, actually, I agree with you, because as I mentioned in my presentation, the bureaucracy is actually the main problem. And this is actually the main problem not only in state level and European Union level, it's a big problem in university level, because you cannot make decision without a big red tape line. So I agree with you that small is beautiful, and in many cases is, but the biggest problem is that universities, big organizations, they are able to collect enough resources to have big research labs, they have infrastructure. So it should be more open to the enterprises coming from outside to also use university laboratories. I even think there is a practice in the world that universities, for instance, during the night time, they rent out their laboratories to the companies. And actually, it's a win-win solution. Companies can do and use university facilities, and also universities can have extra resources.
Yeah, but the primary target of universities is probably education. Would we agree on that?
Yes.
Not the making money out of the research. It's education, education of new generation of people who will replace probably rector and you and me coming to work in the universities after 10 years.
Actually, it very much depends on what kind of universities. If we say a research university, so probably the main mission of universities, new knowledge and technology and education is, I would say, I don't want to offend anyone, much more like a buy-side effect of the research than anything else, because in general there are very intense relationship between education and research, in a sense that research cannot survive without young people and without talents, without students. On the other hand, if we agree that up-to-date modern education is really based not on memorizing facts, but on really learning how to learn, or learning how to solve problems, or learning how to try out and select, then research as a platform is the best way to learn, because you join research projects and you try out your knowledge, you really learn some cognitive skills, and you become really mature for the modern labor market. So they cannot survive without each other.
And you think market will evaluate that the graduates from the law school is quite matured for the labor market?
Yeah, usually law agencies and other businesses ask for alumni that are able to work. That means matured for labor market.
Yes, able to work. In Lithuania, we had a very interesting discussion lasting for a few years about how to evaluate effectiveness of the universities, how to evaluate what is graduated out of the university, what the level, what the skills have, what the career they are doing, how much they earn, how quickly they climb in the career steps, and so on. So where the should research, in fact, meet education? To push the people exactly. It's bachelor studies, it's on the master levels, maybe as it was in UK for sometimes it's in medical, was compulsory to go for a research fellow. For 1 year, just go for research here and here, doesn't matter, but you should go through this, write some articles, to be in conferences, to discuss scientific papers and so on. So where is on your opinion we should try to stick this research and educational activities of university in what phase of education?
I would say just very short that according to my understanding, it's not really possible to separate, and if it is really research university, education and research activity starts from the first day the young fellow, the colleague is coming to the university. Because in that sense, of course, in bachelor, the young person is looking what he can do, he's trying out, but as soon as he can see where the knowledge is born, how it's possible to apply it, I think the education becomes much more motivated. So I would say that education and research starts from the first day students are coming to the university.
I expected you to say in the kindergarten.
Okay. No.
So I want to make sure I understand your question. Are you asking, as a commercial employer, what level of education?
Yep.
Okay. So it really depends, and it's a blend. Depending on, I am happy to take a chance on somebody right out of school, and give them the opportunity. And if they make it, they're going to have an opportunity to grow in the company. If they don't, they won't make it in the company. So, and I think it's our responsibility to make sure that we prepare and give them the right kind of career path. But it really depends, you know. For some of our more senior level positions, you know, we have folks with MDs and PhDs and master's degrees. But it really, it's a blend depending on the various function.
Mm-hmm. Andre.
I go for the kindergarten.
Actually, you stole that from me last night. No, but it's true. I mean, I have a four-year-old daughter, and she was much more creative and artistic 2 years ago when she was homeschooled, and now that she's poisoned by stupid teachers, you know.
And this notice is very good. I like it.
Yeah,
thank you.
I mean, it's real, and you can say from the quality of her visual production, her visual art, she's very much into color and stuff. The moment you get exposed to stereotypes and like a house is like this, I mean, she was drawing things like what is the, now I'm jet lagged, what is the Barcelona, Gaudi.
Gaudi.
Yeah, Gaudi. She was doing that kind of stuff with a building with kind of oblong windows and things and crazy colors. She did, without any exposure to anything, some of the Puntinism, some of the Miro stuff on her own. That means that it's intrinsically in the human DNA to explore with shapes and colors in crazy ways and see what happens. And then if it's something pleasing, then you reinforce it. If it's something ugly, you reject it. Then when you go in a formal environment full of dogmatic teachings, then they say, oh, a house is like this, the roof is brown, the grass is green, the sky is blue. And you see all these kids, they draw the same S word. It's all stupid stuff. It's all the same. So the originality of those kids is erased already at 4.5. And so that's poison to me. It's better to be not schooled at that point.
We have to close the kindergartens and start university at once, not waiting for 12 years.
But actually, think about this. If you have a design, a knowledge approach to design that is actually, I mean, is disciplinary, interdisciplinary at the heart. So you can start. I mean, I'll tell you what we did. Same example. So at school, they draw whatever. She comes home with something that they gave her at school, so the right tool with the wrong actually use. You know, those things for making shapes. So at school, they told her to just put the shapes. And so you just draw the things, the square, the circle, the triangle, and then when you finish, you start a new page. So he said, why don't you just flip the thing and overlap shapes and see what happens? And then she said, I don't know, Daddy, what you're meaning. Well, and then I did it. And then she looked and said, oh, that's really interesting. And now you can color different pieces, different thing. An hour after, she did something very similar to a mural. And then I said, well, that's like a mural. I mean, not me, but actually someone else looked at the picture and said, oh, it looks like something of Miro. And she said, who is Miro? We went on Google. In 10 seconds, I got 50 yeah. pictures of Miro. And she said, oh, yeah, actually, that looks like him. Mine is better. Well, I said, yeah. And then, so then we did, in half an hour, through an accident, so just changing the diagonal inclination of that stuff, a little bit of fine arts, a little bit of color, a little bit of what are compatible color or complementary colors. I mean, she's 4.5, she learned more at 2 at home than now at school. They're still there counting letters. And in US, you live there, we have a huge problem with education. We have 300 million people that are almost illiterate. In 80-90%, they cannot read a newspaper and understand exactly what it says.
I'd say it's worse in the public education yes. than it is private, but yeah.
And she's in also a private kindergarten. I wonder what in the public they do, poor yeah. people. Yeah. But anyway, so... But to come to your question, if you design knowledge in that way, so basically taking away the silos, so you can discuss an issue moving with metaphors and stuff from physics, astronomy, material science, whatever. And of course, at 4, the level of abstraction and the level of codification is 4 or maybe 6. And then the more you go, the more you put in stuff. It's like when you are an artist, the first moment you're drawing something, you don't do something like Leonardo, you do something simple. Then you layer your knowledge, but the framework is the same. And otherwise, we go towards what is called relativism, which is also a big topic in theology and all that, which then everybody can say, oh, that's beautiful, that's ugly, that's correct, that's wrong. Well, there's certain things that are beautiful, certain that are not. And it's just a matter of how we are built. Actually, and I close. This is an interesting thing for Lithuania.
You feel my...
I know. I feel the energy.
Okay.
With the shamans, you learn how to feel.
Okay.
But this is... So I'm working on a project in the 20%. With 3 Nobel Prizes, actually, and other people that are not, but they're smart anyway, so basically the idea is to create a program, probably it's going to be multi-campus and kind of virtual in most cases, with foot on the ground for a couple of weeks, and maybe here you can be a part of that, on beauty, in different fields. So from quantum beauty to design to architectural to urban planning, And beauty is the vision through which to see the disciplines.
Okay, Professor Baršauskas would like to add something, probably about teachers, I guess.
Do you hear me? No. Oh. Anyway, I will speak loudly.
Okay.
So, if you allow to continue this, so at the university. We are not able to change kindergartens. We are not able even to appoint qualified ministers and so on and so on. But we are able to change something inside. I do need advice. You are free to advise anything. You are free to think as a creative person. What would you do immediately from tomorrow with university study program? One or two or three ideas. Especially from business people.
Okay, as a moderator...
What is the main thing you would change?
As a Close moderator, them. I will tell at the end, okay? So, who would like to...
Well, I can continue, so I'm already on fire.
Okay, we switch to you.
So,
So, I'm less pessimistic than my colleague about the state of education, but I do think that you're right, especially in the United States...
Yeah, pessimistics are realistics, usually.
Okay. Right.
The other one, they have endorphins that are sweetened the thing.
So to answer the question, what would I do different? I don't know what I'd do different. I'm not sure. But I do know that if you can get... It starts with, for us, It starts with talent management, and it starts with getting the right people and understanding the strengths of those people. And so what I wouldn't do is put an individual whose strengths do not, that's why we do a lot of testing, because I don't want to put somebody whose strengths don't align with what I need them to do, because they're destined for failure, and it's going to be frustrating for everybody. So for us, it's really about making sure we get great people, let them do great things, don't hold them back, keep them accountable, track it, measure it, all of those things. And so I don't know that I'm answering your question other than to say, you know, there has to be a way to make sure that we're tapping into the greatness of folks, the strengths of folks, and rather than kind of to his, I think the analogy of your daughter, don't force them into a certain paradigm or a certain view, but at the same time, don't withhold them or don't hold them back from the areas that they want to pursue. And so I guess that's our view, is to really just put people in areas that they can excel. And if we don't have enough of those jobs, then we don't hire. And if we have too many people for those jobs, then we have to deal with that. That's my question. My
answer.
Yeah. Right. Yeah, I would like to add one thing, which I actually heard all three of from you, that actually what has happened in recent years with all the education is actually it is getting more and more sophisticated even before the university. It means actually that you cannot separate university and secondary education like it is today. It should be more integrated, because if you choose, after at least in Europe, after grade 9, you choose that you are going to continue, this actually means you already know you are not taking the path of vocational school, you want to go to university. And this 3 years shouldn't be not so much at the moment, it's in Europe quite separated from university studies. It's totally different. At high school, you have normal teachers like you had at basic education. You don't have any kind of knowledge about research possibilities. And secondly, I would like to add that you cannot distinguish research and education at the university level, because if you take, for instance, PhD studies, if you do not have research, you cannot have PhD students. This means all these universities which do not have actually PhD programs, they are like schools, like secondary schools. So basically, universities without research, they do not have possibility to produce offspring. So actually, there should be not so much change maybe in the university level, but the programs, or let's say that from grade 10 to 12, it should be more integrated, the studies with university. So it's like a kind of a pre-bachelor degree or something like that.
Finally, we agree.
Andrea, you would like to comment on that?
Sure. You're buying me a dinner. But I need to say that I was teaching at the university for 8 years. It was a joint program between the Catholic University and UC Berkeley in English on the network economy. So I played with some stuff as well. I think what is missing now is integrative knowledge. So basically, the more you know about the discipline and other disciplines, the more you figure out that the big picture. And I had this conversation last week in Boston with a Nobel Prize, Frank Wilczek. He's an astrophysicist. He says, I understood the potential of religion, even if I'm an atheist, after I won the Nobel Prize, because he figured out five dimension of quarks instead of he believed there were three before. And he said, because there is an inner beauty in quantum physics, and so that could not be chaotic or chaos. So the more you learn about stuff, the more you see that the dynamics, especially the complex level, they are very similar from medicine to material science to here and there. The problem is, if you have students or people that get trained like horses, run fast, straight, they miss the point, because they treat as complicated, complex problems. And that is actually the worst that can happen. I deal every day with top graduated
nincompoops from all over the Ivy League that you can name, and they just are blind to the possibilities that are in a level of uncertainty where the technology is still pliable, when it's not really sure if you can do this, that. My example on carbon nanotubes, but they are blind because they look only in one direction. So you should do this at universities, being able to show them that if you flip and flip and flip and flip, you can see different opportunities.
Yeah. I will. But problem is why they are flipping. Because if you flip like this, you attract social students. If you flip like this, you attract engineers, like this, chemists, and so on. So all universities are trying to become universal universities, but not technical or technological universities. So. Please.
But even more, why? Even more. I fully agree what you say with the creativity. This is crucial importance. But for managers, for leaders who understand the point, how to balance if you allow to do art liberalis, whatever they like to do and teach, then you are in trouble. You have to calculate money. You have to calculate. And how to find the balance?
I think the balance could be, actually, I worked on an exercise that it never got to fruition, but I can share with you, with others, some of the evidence that we did. If you create, for example, a core of courses that are, it doesn't matter if you become a material scientist, if you become an economist, if you become a doctor, you do anthropology, theology, ethics, complexity, applied complexity, and neuroscience, for example, at a level of abstraction that is not for experts, but is for generalists. You put together these four or five disciplines, and mathematics, of course, and then you teach them how to use them as tools. Like if you're running a house, you need to know how to pay the bills, how to do the stuff, if there's a fire, what to do, close the door when you go out. So the basic stuff that anybody should know. And today, I can guarantee you, the basic stuff is not, even if you pick the ultimate PhD guy that is a super expert in his field, he doesn't even know who is Giuseppe Verdi. And so, you talk with robotic people, almost, which means that they don't see the complexity, the nuances. At that point, I prefer the Kurzweil view of artificial intelligence, because if I need a guy that thinks like a robot, give me a robot. The only hope for humans is to be able to deal with complexity, with ambiguity, with uncertainty. If you have a platform technology with 10 potential application, even if you give me all the big data, all the stuff, and show me the stuff, sometime the actual killer application is not what is obvious to anybody. Is the accidents, is things that happen, a eureka moment, is not what it was everybody was counting on. And this is crucial to be flexible. So you can teach how to be resilient. So if you fail, and you will fail, and because a lot of the folks that we train today, they're going to be probably unemployed two or three times in their life. It just depends for how long and how strong they will be redeployed to do what. Because you can do on a trajectory like this, or you can do like this, or you can do like this. So if you make resilient people, meaning they can learn, they can bootstrap, they can reapply existing knowledge in another field. I mean, in my own thing, and it's just me, but out of curiosity, I became a certified sommelier and a winemaker, never worked as. I went to culinary school just because I like to cook, never worked as a cook. I did economics of innovation, and then I did computer science a little bit at Berkeley. And so I only worked in things, but I have skills that I learned from the winemaking, skills that I learned from cooking, actually being able to orchestrate a crew in a kitchen is a very interesting soft skill that you should, because it's a total chaos in a kitchen. And the quality control is crucial, but have you ever heard of anybody in a business school that teaches some of those principles taken from a culinary institute? I don't. There's a very dogmatic view of what is a business school. And as a consequence, you find stuff that is all over, identical all over the place. You go to Shenzhen, you go to MIT, you go everywhere, they all copy the dogmatic MBA format of whatever. And that's why there's not that much innovation going on. If I look what happened in the labs and how we live, it's a shame. We leave the life of 30 years behind what we could. But most people don't even know because they don't go in the labs. And so they are happy no matter what. Actually, they think that we are making a lot of progress. Yeah, we don't.
Andrea, we can applaud
I'm
for
this. I'm a pessimist.
In fact,
I'm
all
a cynic.
What you mentioned, Miro, Gaudi, Hundertwasser, who's again architect with the funny buildings, and the Nobel Prize winners. I am sorry to say, but they're a little bit crazy, because they are concentrated and they look to the life a little bit differently. And they have idea what to do and how to see everything. So this creativity probably is killed by our educational systems all over the world. In the United States and in Lithuania for sure, where we have about 10% of pensioners working still in the educational system, in the secondary education. You wanted to add something.
Oh yeah, I wanted to just add a small remark to Andrea, because you told about these native people and their creativity, but in Lithuania, Estonia, we do not have this problem because we come from Soviet Union time, and during that time, every person was very creative because we were all the time lack of resources. So we were able to do anything from anything to something. So this is a question of creativity comes from the lack of resources, actually.
Scarcity drives innovation a lot. That's a good tip for incubators. Don't flood them with money like we do in the US, because then you get a bunch of people that are chasing the money and telling what you want to hear.
The discussion was on the European level, on the Council of Ministers of Education, what to do with universities, how to increase their creativity and better outcome for the society. Is a good answer from the Holland-Dutch minister was, don't give them money. It will increase their creativity, going towards the business collaboration and so on and so on. It's of course joking, but you just said something similar.
It's scarcity, but I need to add one thing short, I promise. There are two things about creativity and problem solving and that. So I agree, if you create starvation or scarcity of resources, you for sure figure it out at some point, unless you die first. The problem is how long it takes. So instead, if you, on top of not being lavish in resources when you start something or when you sit fund a program or a project, if you also teach them how to think with there are pretty straightforward techniques. There are several, you know, using metaphoric thinking, using translation, using symmetry, flipping concepts up and down, and it's also nice exercises for your brain. But also, it teaches them how to challenge what they're looking, how to probe the whatever they're trying to change quickly, because otherwise it may take 15 years before and you realize the places that are attracting more people, more talent, more companies, more money, more everything are places where they can figure out fairly quickly what are the possibilities to disrupt or to change or to flip something. And so it's not by trial and error in an indefinite linear way, but you need to know what to do. And I agree that scarcity helps, but just scarcity is gonna help, and by the time you figure out what it is already obsolete. So you need to also teach them how to think.
Okay, so we from the scarcity, we jump into the overwhelming money. If we have, let's say, 500 billion euro in the pocket, in Lithuanian pocket. So where would you concentrate this money, talking about university business collaboration, keeping in mind all educational issues, what we were talking about? So 500 million, and you are free as a Lukashenko to put money where you want.
That's a good question, and first of all, I would say that if I would know the right answer, I wouldn't sit here, but I would be somewhere else.
All right.
At least for Lithuania, specifically for Lithuania.
For Lithuania.
But first of all, I would say where I wouldn't put it, because all kind of support measurements are not working because it's like a pile of logs which are not put in right order. So, and if you put supports for the pile of logs which is falling, so it holds until you take away these supports and then it falls down. So basically the most important and key issue is you have to change the system. So you cannot do it like with this money, you cannot change it overnight. So basically you should start rebuilding some blocks of the system so it shouldn't fall down.
So do I correctly understand you suggest to bribe the politicians to take the correct decisions for the future?
This was not correct.
All right.
How did you realize that?
All right. So, Andrea, your turn.
I think I would try to establish Lithuania. I mean, some of the weaknesses of Lithuania could become strengths. So Lithuania is a relatively small place, geographically speaking, so it's comparable to a region in other places. There's about 3 million people, which is compared to a mid-sized city in the world, but there is also there is a very highly educated on average, especially in the youth, young population. It's an open country in terms of, you know, they're open to historically to new ideas and things. So I would establish Lithuania as a platform for translating technologies from applied research, not just from Lithuania, from all over the world. Something like Singapore is doing very well, or Qatar is trying to do something like that. So basically, you could do what your king did many years ago in trying to send an open letter or an email or whatever, a pigeon, to the different tribes of research around the world that you want to partner with and say, hey, you need to do clinical trials, you need to do social experimentation on your technologies to see at scale if something works or not. We can do it using Lithuania as a living lab. It's an attempt that the Faroe Islands tried to do. They failed because there were people who wanted to do fishing, other people were doing the genome project, so they were confused. Other people in Iceland tried to do that, mostly for genomics. But you could do it for a bunch of stuff, from digital health to robotic surgery to how drones are impacting life of people. Are they really whatever? Because the FAA is regulating the regulators in Italy, they regulate the drones. Nobody knows how it works. So, for example, you can be a platform for integrating foreign IP with a clear path to say, okay, you can keep a part of the development at home, but by definition, because we put some of the money co-investing, you do part of the development here, similar to what I do, and then you can stimulate your local community of inventors and PIs, not just at Kaunas, but all the universities in Lithuania, to say, hey, if you have any IP that is complementary to this stuff or is better, we then portfolio IP around this, because again, IP doesn't mean anything. There is at least 70, 80 research groups around the world doing every single thing you can pick, more or less at the same stage. And I lived it on my thing. The problem is that someone are more ahead of others, or more resilient, or they have backbone IP that could be an issue in freedom to operate. So it's pure a fantasy to say, oh, we have IP of what? You need to compare it with other competitors around. So the best way to go, also for venture, is create portfolios of IP around something that you can own or you can control. Because the most profitable business are not competitive business. They are duopolies, monopolies, or de facto monopolies. Google is a de facto monopoly. Facebook it is, not by law, but because it gets that critical mass. And so basically you can do a platform. In this way you disrupt the locals, everybody, because if you start bringing in people that are better, faster, and smarter than you, the level of competition increases. Actually, by the time a lot of players in basketball from Lithuania, from Italy, from Spain, they went in the NBA, now you see that the local championship are a lot better. Why?
No, actually, because it was vice versa, I have to say. Huh? NBAs were coming here, now they play very well.
Well, but how many they go there and how many they stay?
I would say so they increase. The school of basketball was here much earlier than you can expect. So
typical Kaunas. Typical Kaunas. But it's good. But it's good.
And so basically, imagine this: that you become a platform, you start actually having externalities, positive externalities from the fact that the research and development happens here, even if the IP comes from somewhere else. And then on the other side of the equation, you engage on a global scale, starting with Lithuanian companies, but not necessarily, with companies, mm-hmm. both early stage or later stage, incumbent, whatever, and say, hey, you wanna try something else? You wanna experiment on a new product, a new service, a new business model? We are the living lab. You can put 1 million people on it, even pay these people, even if it's not a clinical trial. You can pay them for a digital trial or whatever. And so it becomes source of revenue for them and it's real users, you know. That could be very valuable.
Okay, it's a good idea. I love it.
Okay, so I would think of three things. One is, you know, we're doing it now, right? So we're investing in the university with the Creativity Lab. So I think more investments in innovation and collaboration with commercial businesses is a good thing. I think the second, to Andrea's point, is kind of around the immigration, I guess, or the access to talent. You know, I think of Lithuania, it is the size population of where I live in Orange County, California. And it's, you know, what we have in Orange County in terms of 3 million people compared to 3 million here. And I think that's a constraint. So I think there has to be some review of immigration in order to access people and to get good, talented folks here. And I know there's all kinds of issues associated with that. And then I think the third element has to do with labor, or some of the labor reform issues that are going on, which we're watching. And for example, the way we interpret the ability to have internships is a constraint within the country. And maybe that's a misinterpretation, and I'd be happy to talk about it. And I know that the parliament is going to be looking at some labor reform legislation coming up.
Yeah.
But that's another area that I think the country needs to focus on.
Okay, thank you. And Asta.
So I have 0 minutes to say my final words, but
it means
thank you, Andrea,
time.
For that.
Unlimited time.
Of course, who takes first? So in that sense, I just want to say that seriously, talents are really important and matters, and I think the more diverse and talented people we have, but talented doesn't mean that they really have some, you know, what other people can't have. Actually, talented means curious, motivated, and eager to learn, according to my understanding, talents. Of course, we need to have talented people and be open. And but on the other hand, I think it's very important to give a taste of what we offer. And if finally somebody would give us resources, I would first of all build interactive science museum, so pupil can start playing there with different interesting things. And then probably I would equip at least Kaunas people with smart environments. That means really taking some technologies to the homes. People would really try out what we can do. And in that sense, really being thirsty for the next innovation. And in some sense, I would say that the United States are really interesting place, because each time I go, they're really looking forward to get to the hotel as fast as possible and try coffee machine. Because in each hotel, the coffee machines are really different, and you have to think, you know, cognitive skills, enhance cognitive skills, how to make coffee. And
free of charge.
No, that's fine. Yeah, you pay for hotel quite a lot, I have to say.
Yes.
So coffee is free of charge, but also with a learning experience, you know, how to make coffee. But I think it's a symbol that innovations are really welcome in everyday life. You know, because if you go to our European hotels, the coffee machines are the same everywhere. Maybe it's very effective, but
No, don't say all machines are the same. Andrea, as Italian, should say it's Saeco, it's different.
I was actually looking, there is a company in Singapore that they bought on Kickstarter, one of the first thing. And it's a mini espresso machine for the airplane. It's something that you do by yourself with this little thing, and it comes as creamy as the best you can do. So you can standardize your stuff, you bring it with you, portability of espresso stuff. It's really cool, $80.
Espresso is good.
You don't find the picture.
So, dear participants, dear panel, our session came to the logic end. I would thank everybody for participation. I see Rector will give some small presents, yes. And somebody should tell us when bus is leaving towards Vilnius for the dinner at the Arsenal. It's a nice place. What's about food? I don't know. So thank you for being here. Thank you, everybody.
First of all, thank you for all of you so much. Thank you. Thank you.